Thank you, everyone, for coming this evening. I know that there are a lot of other things that you can't be doing on a Sabbath evening, but I really, really, really appreciate that you decided to spend it this evening with me and my family. And I want to kind of reiterate what I said earlier today, that tonight's Vespers is a culmination of several weeks and actually months of study and also contemplation. I had been praying about this for a very long time. Last quarter, when we studied the aspects of the church and the community and our responsibility in growing the faith outside of these walls here, that's when there started to be this desire to do something. And then our church family, several of us, met for a couple of weeks and started working on some things, some ideas about how we could do this. And then I started school in the fall, and I didn't know what the curriculum was going to be, because it's a set program, and this is a transcultural nursing program. And so at the beginning of the semester, the professor talked about this capstone project and how we were going to need to develop our skill set in being able to interview people and also be culturally competent. And at the outset, when I was thinking about this, I thought, oh, this is going to be an easy class. You know, it's one of those classes where it's a gimme classes. The pathophys is going to be my hard one, and biostatistics. As it turns out, this class has been every bit as challenging, if not more so, than the other classes, because it's a language that's unfamiliar to me. And while a lot of it's intuitive, you know, we know how to be nice to people. We know what we're supposed to say to people. But to actually, this class has forced me to look at myself in a way that you do when you're a Christian and examine what your values are, what your beliefs are. And then at the same time, my father was diagnosed with cancer, and it's terminal. And so all of this stuff was happening at the same time. This wanting to build here at church, this starting over again in my career, and then my roots, my father, he's going to leave us. And I thought, why is all this happening at the same time? And this class has kind of brought it together for me, believe it or not. Because as I studied these concepts, I thought, this is very much in tandem, in line with the principles that we are supposed to be learning as Christians, where me being a nurse for the last 20 years has been about me serving people and taking care of people and doing things for people. And this class has kind of flipped everything around and said, you're still supposed to do, but you're not supposed to do from the perspective of you. You're supposed to do from the perspective of the patient. And my dad being a patient in all kinds of settings right now has made me be kind of like the family. We are the family, but like the recipient of the care, and seeing where I could do things better. And so when the professor said, she rolled out this assignment, she said, I want you to teach this to fellow nurses. And I thought about that, and I said, I could do that. That's easy. You know, you talk in front of your peers, that's not a big deal. But I thought, I want to think bigger than this. And I prayed about it, and I said, Lord, what can we do with this? And the resounding answer over and over again, despite different tacks along the way, was that this message needs to be preached to all of our people, regardless of what type of work you do, because this is based and rooted in how we treat people and how we need to approach other cultures and other ethnicities. So that's when I went to my teacher and I said, you know, one of the things that our little group here talked about was in the future opening parish nursing here in this congregation. And we have a lot of medical people here, believe it or not. And we have, if we did open parish nursing here, we would also need the resource and the ability to minister to people's physical needs, you know, and their emotional needs. They're going to need food. They're going to need clothing. And so I approached my professor and I said, you know what? It's my sincere hope and desire at the Lord's leading that we do something like this, and that's why I would like to present to my church family. And at first she said, I don't know about that. You know, she's like, I don't know. And I said, well, I'm going to submit the paperwork anyway. So I did, and she read everything over, and she came back with overwhelming support and said, please go forward and do this. I think you should do this. I'm excited for you. So that's basically where this idea came from, and I am so thrilled to be able to share this with you that I see this as an opportunity for me to also get feedback from you. So after this is over, and you've had time to kind of digest it, I'm so open to you coming to me and giving me feedback and saying, this is what I think about that, this is what you could do better. And then the caveat to all of this is, I see this as an opportunity because this is going to be videotaped, this is documented, all of this gets submitted to my professors. I get to insert my personal Christian beliefs. I get to talk about my faith and being a Seventh-day Adventist, and it's going to be spread out and disseminated against my entire cohort. So they're going to be looking at this and reading this. And I firmly believe that we are living in the end times. I know my grandmother said that. I know her, you know, grandmother said that. But I, and you know what, here's the bottom line for that. When I'm dead, it is my end time, right? So this is why I say at every opportunity that we have, let's go out, let's disseminate, and it starts with us. We don't have to do it as a church group, we can do it as individuals. We can do it as a church group, or we cannot do it as a church group. The most important thing for us to remember is that God is here to help us spread his word to his people who are waiting. And we have this opportunity. So before we begin, I'd like to pray, and then I'd love if we sing a few songs and then get into it. Dear Heavenly Father, I come before you so not qualified and so not free of speech. Like Moses, I am tongue-tied and somebody who is afraid. But Lord, I lay myself at your feet and ask you to use me as your servant. And also, Lord, I know that there are individuals here tonight who came presenting themselves before you. We all are seeking, Lord, to know your will and your way. And if it be that we are not clean enough and that we need to be broken more, may we receive that rebuke with open fire, just in bold and brave people. And we ask for forgiveness of our sins in happiness in all of our lives. So let's give Does anyone have a favorite? All right. 290? 290. You see. I sing the last verse. Does anyone else have a favorite they'd like to sing? Well, why don't we sing 534? We'll sing the first and the fifth verse. Will your anchor hold in the storm of life when the clouds unfold their wings of strife? When the strong tides lift and the cable string, will your anchor drift or firm remain? We have an anchor that keeps the soul steadfast and sure while the billows into the rock which cannot move, grounded firm and deep in the Savior's love. When our eyes behold in the dawning light shining gates of pearl our harbor bright, we shall anchor fast to the heavenly shore with the storms all past for us. Sure, while the billows roll, fastened to the rock which cannot move, grounded firm and deep in the Savior's love. Thank you. So the first couple of slides that I have here are fun slides. And this is a picture for you to look at. What do you see when you look at this picture? Do you see a little girl or do you see an elderly woman? A dignified older woman. Do you see the young lady? How about the next slide? What is that? Could be two faces or it could be a table leg, right? And the reason why I put these two slides up here is about perspective. I read something once where a teacher had a round table and she had an eclectic collection of things that she placed all over the table. And then she had her class sit around the table and write down all the things that they saw. And interestingly enough, when she collected all the papers, they were in a 360 circle. Interestingly enough, when she had them return the papers to her and she was grading them, the exercise was successful because she noted that not one person had the same list of things on their paper. And that was because it was an exercise in perspective. So even though the table contained exactly the same things and everyone had the same things to look at, they couldn't see everything at the same time. I wanted to talk a little bit about our church and its mission. I found this really interesting. I don't know if any of you are familiar with the Pew Research Center, but it's a secular entity that has their own website and they conduct surveys all the time. And this particular survey that they were focusing on was how racially diverse are U.S. religion groups. And did you know that Seventh-day Adventists ranked number one as the most diverse Protestant denomination, actually any religious group, any denomination in the United States as being most diverse? And then I started thinking about Mrs. White and all of her writings. And there, you know, there's volumes and volumes of things that she's written, very beautiful. But her charge over and over again, and really it's not her charge, it's the charge of our Heavenly Father, is that we are supposed to be connected with our fellow men as God's instrumentality work in their behalf. So we are supposed to be serving, have an attitude of servitude towards others. Then I wanted to look at, what's it like in Waterford? What's it like in Pontiac? So this graph depicts, it's kind of hard to tell, but the lighter, the turquoise color is the demographic makeup of Pontiac versus the demographic makeup of Waterford. And the reason why I chose these two cities is because we obviously are housed here in Waterford. This is our home. And then a lot of our efforts that we have thought about over the last couple of months was to do fan out and reach out to the community, and Pontiac being our sister community and demonstrating a tremendous amount of need, it was interesting to see what the demographic makeup was. So if we look at that, we see that there are a number of different cultures and ethnicities dispersed throughout these two communities. And like I said before, what I'm going to ask you to do over the next few minutes is to start thinking introspectively about yourself and your views about your culture, your perspective and your views about other cultures and what you know about them. So I'm going to start from the beginning. This is like my real formal stuff, okay? My name's Lorraine Zdravkovsky, and I'm a student at the University of Michigan, Flint. I'm currently pursuing a doctoral degree in nursing practice. So it's my intent to become a nurse practitioner. And over the course of this semester, I've had the opportunity to study advanced cultural nursing, and I'm going to be presenting important aspects of this discipline of study that contribute to the uniquely distinguished care that nurses provide. Unlike other disciplines, nursing has this component of transcultural nursing. You don't see it in medicine, you don't see it in psychology. They have aspects of it, but nursing actually focuses their care around this. This is a central core discipline. I'm going to share over the next few minutes the inspiration and creativity imparted by my professors and gathered from my studies in transcultural nursing to hopefully spark an interest and desire in you to achieve your best level of cultural competence. Our objectives for tonight are to discuss cultural competence, and I'm going to also be talking about transcultural nursing history specifically and the tenets of Dr. Leininger's culture care theory. I'm also going to be discussing the process of becoming culturally competent using enablers and cultural assessment steps. And finally, we're going to be reviewing the application of culture care modes through examples from my personal clinical practice or those of others of my colleagues. So this is Dr. Leininger, and you can't talk about transcultural nursing without highlighting her. She was born in 1925 in Sutton, Nebraska, and at 23, she received her nursing diploma while serving in the United States Army Nurse Corps. And then 2 years later, she received her Bachelor of Science in Biological Science, and then 4 years after that, obtained her Master of Science degree in nursing with a minor in psychiatric mental health nursing and psychology. So picture this woman starting off in the 40s and 50s, you know, progressing through. Back then, you know, it was not very common for a woman to be credentialed like this. Then in addition to that, she, in the 1950s, decided that she really wanted to study the different cultures, and her impetus for doing that was because she was very much dedicated to developing and establishing a formal area of study and practice that really understood and therapeutically responded to clients from different cultures. And she realized early on that the current tools available just were not good facilitators for her to obtain this information. So in 1965, Dr. Leininger earned her PhD in cultural and social anthropology, which made her the first nursing professional to earn this degree. What you see over here is a picture of Dr. Leininger with the Gatsup children in Papua New Guinea, and she spent a number of years and then went back to study with these people. But as I said before, earlier in her career, she noticed that there were some critical deficits in the care delivery, and she intuitively identified that the lack of care was really rooted in inattention to or a misunderstanding of clients' needs. So she tried to use the current psychoanalytic and other mental health ideas popular after World War II, but was unsuccessful. And recognizing that if she continued to use these tools, nothing would really come of it, she decided, I'm going to develop them myself. I will develop tools that will enable myself and others in this discipline to be able to provide culturally competent care. She's known as a pioneer of transcultural nursing. So the development of culture care theory is basically two-pronged. It deals with the provider and it deals with patients, with the ultimate goal or intent of having culture-specific and meaningful care. The culture care theory maintains that care is the cornerstone of nursing. Like I said before, unlike other professions or healthcare professions or disciplines, they don't necessarily focus on care. I need to give you medication or we need to do these type of activities for you. But nursing is really rooted, even though we do those things as nurse practitioners, it's rooted in the care aspect of health maintenance and well-being. And Dr. Leininger, one of her, I watched an interview of hers, and one of the things that she stated really, it touched my heart. And this was back in 2008, and she said, "Why in the world did we think we could care for people of diverse cultures of the world and not know something about what is their culture and what does care mean to the culture?" She says those were very important research and theoretical questions that had to be addressed. Well, in her model, she said the purpose of the culture care theory is to discover, document, know, and explain the interdependence of care and culture phenomena with differences and similarities between and among cultures. And really, if you think about that, in your own family, you have your personal culture, right? You may have a certain ethnicity that you identify with, but that's not necessarily completely representative of the culture that your roots are identified with. I'll give you an example. My husband is Serbian, and when I first met him, and they have some really different cultural practices, I thought to myself, wow, this is really interesting. They have really, really big weddings, and they have really, really big baby showers, and they have everything is really big. Everybody gets invited. And I said to my husband, how can people afford that? You know, because I came from a home where we did everything small. And he said, well, that's a practice that is really Serbian American, not Serbian back home. And I said, what do you mean? And he said, well, back home, we invite the whole village and we invite everybody, but everybody knows everybody and it's kind of small and it's like that there. But he said, now that we're here in America, we kind of do the same thing, but we invite everybody we know that's connected to our culture. So it isn't unheard of to have weddings that are 500 and 600 big. That's just the way it is. They have large families. And so that's my example of how even in your own culture, you can have variation. And this is important for you to keep in mind because not everybody is the same. We may know somebody of a certain ethnicity and know certain things about them, but there's all this interplay that we're going to get into in the next several slides that really impact why a person is the way they are and why they need what they need. So the thing to remember is that nursing care practices are universal. You know, changing Foley's, changing dressings, administering medication, prescribing medication, those are universal. Those are things that all nurses do across the board. Patients universally have personal worldviews. They have social structures, they have values. Those things are considered to be emic. The things that we do to patients are considered to be etic. But in this picture that I have down here in the corner, the one main thing to remember is that you cannot connect what we do for patients and do to patients with their need unless you're using and employing culturally congruent care. Our patients are our informants, and they have knowledge of generic folk care, meaning that only your patient can tell you what they need. And then our ultimate goal in marrying these two through culturally congruent care is to have therapeutic health outcomes. Cultural competence has a number of definitions that are used to define what it is exactly, and there's not one single definition that fully embodies what cultural competence is, but there is a common thread. So cultural competence, mainly the thing you want to remember, is a process. There's not a single endpoint, and it's not, I read about it and I'm culturally competent now. This is something that spans your lifetime and you get better at as you continue to employ these principles. It also requires that you have a deep respect for and honor multicultural perspectives. And then it results in care that is individualized and effective. According to Dr. Leininger, nursing is a doing culture where nurses are always doing something. They feel like they need to do something to the patient, and this doing, she says, must be linked with a dominant construct, which is trust. But before you can achieve trust, the number one, highest, most universal construct is respect. That respect needs to be established. And that's pretty intuitive, right? A person can't trust you unless they know that you respect them. And how is it that you convey respect? It's by being open-minded and listening. As my mom says, less talk, more listen. So the theory of culture care, diversity, and universality has four tenets to it, and one of those tenets has three predictions. It's the first tenet has to do with culture care. So the theory espouses that culture care expressions, meanings, and patterns, and practices are diverse. But as I said before, even though they're diverse, they share some commonalities and some universal attributes. So you can have a person that's Irish or a person that's Korean, and they could be very varied in the way that they approach care, but there are some things that are the same, like don't hurt me, keep me informed, those type of things. And then the second tenet has to do with critical influencers. Critical influencers of culture patterns are used to predict health, well-being, illness, healing, and ways that people face disabilities and death. So that's another aspect of care that we need to keep in mind. Sometimes it's not going to be about making a person better. Sometimes it's going to be about helping a person through death and helping the family cope with the reality that death is imminent. The Sunrise Enabler that I'm showing you right now is actually a cognitive map that Dr. Leininger produced that is a tool for nurses and any healthcare professional to use in guiding them through the process of interviewing and finding out this information. So when you're on your quest to gain knowledge about a person and their culture, this tool is invaluable. And actually, one of the exercises we did for this semester, I had the privilege of interviewing somebody and using this, and it was just wonderful. It prevents you from going all over the place when you're needing to get information. And then the third has to do with health factors. Health factors, as I kind of touched on before, can either be generic and emic, which are folk practices. Those are things that are taught, they are passed down traditions that are done within the family, or they can be etic, which are professional practices. Those are learned. Those are ones that you obtain through education. But in different environmental contexts, they have significant impact to health and illness outcomes. And then the last tenet is three major actions and decision guides. And these are used to render culturally congruent and safe, meaningful healthcare to cultures. They are culture preservation, culture care accommodation, culture care repatterning or restructuring. And I'll go into greater detail in a few more slides. This right here is basically taking Dr. Leininger's Sunrise model and segueing it into her semi-structured inquiry guide enabler. So she developed this tool here on the left, which is a pictorial representation of the approach to cultural care theory, and it's intentionally entitled the Sunrise Enabler, because if you think about the rays of the sun, do they stay? No, they fan out, and they fan out far and wide. And so as you, as the nurse or healthcare professional, work through these questions, you're delving in and out and fanning out into areas that won't be just confined to that individual. It'll take you on a further journey. You'll learn first about that individual, then you'll learn about that individual's family, then you will learn about that that family and the culture that they are in, and you may learn about subcultures in there, and then it fans on, so on and so forth. There are 12 domains of inquiry that she has the researcher focus on, and Leininger's Sunrise Enabler assists nurses in expanding their views in culture care discoveries by identifying factors that could potentially influence human care phenomena. The 12 domains of inquiry originate from the Sunrise Enabler. So if you look at the sunrise, it's the middle portion there, and it serves as a guide to researchers in developing open-ended, semi-structured questions to facilitate questioning of informants in gaining insight and discovering nursing phenomena. So when I used this tool in my interview, it was very helpful because while I didn't have canned questions, I had cues that let me know this is a topic that I need to touch on to get some information about X and move on. So I'd like to go over the suggested domains of inquiry, the first one being technology. And so when you're interviewing your patient, you're going to be asking questions like, how do technological factors help or hinder? Or what role does technology play in your health and wellness? And this is important because depending on where you're from, technology can be your friend or it can be your foe. When I was pregnant with Abby, I went for my 20-week ultrasound, and the results came back abnormal. There was a portion of the ultrasound that they were not able to complete because of her positioning, and every time we had tried twice, she would always curl her legs up in a ball or put her legs up over her head so they couldn't see her abdomen. And so the OB said, you're going to need to do a level 2 ultrasound. And I said, okay. So, you know, being a nurse, I didn't think anything of it. I thought, yes, I need to do this to protect the health of my baby. And they said, we might be able to find out whether or not she has birth defect, but we really need you to go do this. And mind you, my pregnancy with Abigail was a horrible one. It was rife with all kinds of sickness. And this was probably my 6th ultrasound with her. So when I went home and I told my mom, I called my mom, because you tell your mom everything when you're pregnant, right? I called my mom and I said, I have to have this level 2 ultrasound. And she said, oh, another ultrasound? And I said, yeah. And she goes, well, if that's what you have to do, then my older sister, now mind you, my older sister and I are very close. I love her dearly. She got wind of it. She's out in Portland and she called me up. She's like, you shouldn't do any more ultrasounds. That's so bad for the baby. You should not do any more ultrasounds. And I was like distraught, right? Stressed out. The reason why I'm telling you this is from my mother's culture, in the Korean culture, now it's not like that now because Korea now is not what Korea was in the 1950s and 60s and 70s. My mom froze in the Korea of 1950s, 60s, and 70s, right? And my grandmother was like that too. You didn't go see the doctor unless your leg was hanging off or you were on death's doorstep. So she's like, why are you doing all this stuff to the baby? You know she's fine. You just pray and everything's fine. And I said, Mom, I don't know everything's fine. And my sister called me up and she said, why are you doing all this? Is it so bad for the baby? That gave me a lot of pressure and stress, right? But you see, that was something that was internal. What if we carried those type of practices to our patient population, right? The things that I value and I cherish and I worry about, I might not realize that I'm imposing those values and beliefs on my patient by either not sharing the information or not being as enthusiastic about it or not being good at reading how they're responding to my cues. Then the next domain of inquiry is education. How you ask your patients, how does education contribute to your health and wellness? What are your views about the importance of education for nurses and others who care for you? A good example of this in my clinical practice was when I was a public health nurse, and I used to go into the homes and I had to do well baby visits. And before that, sometimes I would get referrals when I had teenage moms that were pregnant, real young. And we had a hard time getting the moms to agree to breastfeeding. And as many of you know, breastfeeding has a number of virtues. It helps with the immunity of the baby. It also helps with bonding. It also helps with mother's health. There are a number of different physiologic aspects and psychological aspects of breastfeeding that are very beneficial and valuable to the mom. But in that setting with the younger folks, they didn't go for that, right? They're like, ew, yuck, gross. So one of the things that you have to find out is, how do you value education? And even though you might be amongst a population of individuals who at that particular age aren't interested in education, it's still important to pursue it. I did have opportunity to talk to the young ladies and invite their partners in, or invite their mothers into the conversation, who then would help the mother understand the importance of it, and then it boils down to a choice. Just like in our Christian walk, you offer information, but it's not our responsibility or duty to enforce that in an individual. You share the information, you let the person make an informed choice. And then the third dimension has to do with language. And language is a big one, especially if you have a language barrier. Some of the things that you want to be asking yourself when you're interviewing your client are, what are the verbal or nonverbal encounters that I'm witnessing? And what sort of things do I notice are influencing care patterns? The best example that I can offer is when I worked at the health department as a public health nurse, and we had an immunization clinic as well as an STD clinic, and frequently we would have people there that were non-English speaking. And due to the nature of the type of diseases that we were screening for and treating, it was a very sensitive topic. And so language was a barrier, and sometimes people would come with their mother-in-law, or they would come with an aunt, and they would have to be disclosing very personal information that I didn't think would necessarily be appropriate for them to have knowledge of. So then me as a nurse, I would need to intervene and get interpretive services. Because even though the patient may provide somebody for themselves to do the interpretation, you as the provider need to make an assessment and say, maybe this isn't appropriate. And in a gentle, nice way, still allow for that individual to maybe take part of the initial portion of the physical assessment, and then ask them to be excused, always getting the patient's input. Sometimes the patient would say, no, it's fine, we share everything, it's no problem. And other times they would hold my hand afterwards and say, you know, in their language, and I would find out through the interpreter, thank you so much, this was really embarrassing, but I had no other way. Nonverbal cues are big in those situations. The thing that I want you to keep in mind, though, about language is that, unlike the other domains, except for ethnohistory, and we'll get to that one last, it influences each dimension. So language affects technology, it affects education, it affects all the other ones that we're going to talk about. Economy is another one that's of big concern. You need to be asking your patients, or thinking about, how does money influence their health? Who are the wage earners of the family? Are they insured? A lot of things that we see now in healthcare with the increasing cost, my dad's age group, you know, he always is saying to me, you know, I'm living on a fixed income now, but the prices just keep going higher. We are seeing now where some elderly patients are having to choose between what medications they're able to take. This month I'll take this blood pressure medication. Next month I'll take my cholesterol medication. And these are things that we need to be cognizant of, so that we are not quick to judge and say, well, why is your blood pressure out of control? You know, I had a coworker tell me that her mother lives on a fixed income. She's a diabetic, she has high cholesterol, and she has high blood pressure. And she tries to give her mom money to help her out month to month, but she said sometimes the money's short for her too. And she said the other day when she took her mom to see the cardiologist screamed at her because I guess her blood pressure was like 195 over 100. And he said, "Did you take your blood pressure medication?" And she said, "I didn't." "Why didn't you take your blood pressure medication?" And he read her the riot act. She didn't, that wasn't the pill that she was going to take this week. She was staggering her medications out. So, yes, we need to work on getting resources to help her be able to get her medication, but at the same time, yelling at her wasn't the right approach. The next domain of inquiry is religion and philosophy. How do beliefs and practices help in keeping well or regaining health for yourself and others? And a good example I'd like to share with this is something that happened to me recently. I recently went back to floor nursing at the hospital, and it had been 15 years since I did bedside nursing. And so a lot of technology happened in the last 15 years, and a lot of new drugs came out. But anyways, I had two patients, as it turned out, two patients in the same week that were Jehovah's Witnesses, and they both were elderly individuals in their 90s. And one gentleman came in after falling and having broken a couple of ribs, and he had broken a femur, and they were getting ready to do surgery, but they ran into a problem because his hemoglobin was very low. And as you may or may not know, Jehovah's Witnesses do not believe in accepting blood products or blood, and that's a religious, conscientious decision, and they don't do it because they believe that it's biblically based, that life comes from God, and that there is life in blood, and so they don't receive from other people because God is a giver of life. I went into the patient's room and I said hello and I walked out and I was getting a report from the nurse, and she said to me, "They're not going to do anything for him because his hemoglobin's so low." And I said, "Okay, well, you know he's a Jehovah's Witness, okay." And so I got report, and then my manager came to every day we had to do this shift report, and I said to her, "What are we going to do for this patient?" And she said, "Well, he's refused blood transfusion, so there's really nothing we can do for him. We're going to try to find placement for him. They're not going to do surgery with the hemoglobin that low, so we're going to try to find placement," meaning they were going to try to get him to a nursing home. And so she said, "We're going to get social work involved," and yada, yada, yada. Then I had the second patient, and she also was an elderly individual who fell. She ended up having surgery, and then after surgery, her hemoglobin went very low. And she had to have hip replacement because the hip broke. So I'm thinking to myself, "Oh no, what are they going to do with this patient now? Are they going to ship her off too? Like this? Are we going to try to stabilize her? What are we going to do?" So this time I approached the doctor and I said, "Isn't there something that we can do for this patient?" And he said, "Oh yeah." He said, "We're going to order iron for this patient, and we're going to order erythropoietin or epoietin. And that's, it's a medication that helps to build red blood cells." And he's like, there's several things that we can do for the patient to, you know, to help build blood. I know that she doesn't want blood transfusion, but we'll work on that." And he said, "She has kidney failure too, so there are a couple of things that we're going to have to be juggling around, but this is what we'll do." And I walked away from that encounter thinking to myself, how vastly different the approaches were, right? And they had different physicians. You had one doctor that was like, "We can give that patient iron, but that's about it." And then I had another patient whose doctor said, "No, there's several things that we need to do." So I digress a little bit by talking about that because there are two things that need to be kept in mind. You need to be sensitive to people's religious preferences and their philosophies, and to not be judgmental and not wash your hands of them just because you don't know the answer. There are materials out there, and there's some things that I read when I was putting this together where some modalities that are out there are specifically designed for religions that don't allow for blood transfusions, so they have designed certain algorithms to treat low hemoglobin. And so it's really important for us to, A, not be judgmental, and B, always think outside of the box. There's always another way. And it may have been that that individual would have chosen to just do palliative care and go to a nursing home. But again, you want to be able to give them informed choices and give them the full gamut or array of options that are out there. And lastly, politics on this slide. Within your community, what political or legal problems tend to influence well-being or handicap life ways? And right now, with what happened with the election recently, this is another opportunity for us to see how people react very differently. You know, they react very differently. Some people were really upset and disappointed with the election results of 2012, and now we have the election results of 2016, and we have people that are up in turmoil. We have to keep that in mind. That may be part of the communication barrier when you're talking to your patient. And then we have two more domains of inquiry, kinship and social factors, and this is pretty much a intuitive one. Everybody recognizes that kin or your social network really influences your life, especially how you care for yourself and how you care for others. And then cultural values, beliefs, and life ways are also another domain to be explored. What values and beliefs would you like your nurse to know about to help you regain or maintain your health? That's the question you should be asking your patient. What do I need to know about you to take better care of you? What do you need from me? And another thing that I want you to kind of keep in mind too is this is where self-assessment is really important. How you perceive the family unit, what do you define as family? That may not be what somebody else defines as family. And it could be very different from patient to patient. The important thing to remember is you need to know what your value set is so that you are aware to not interpose and place those values on another individual. Again, to be culturally competent, you need to be aware of what you value so that you don't exercise prejudice and so that you are not being ethnocentric in the care that you deliver, but also so that you are open to learning about other people's way of life. You can reach people better if you're doing it from their perspective. And lastly, the last domain of inquiry is ethnohistory. As the word implies, ethnohistory refers to a person's history, their culture, and is person specific. So my sister and I can have different ethnohistories. Consideration needs to be given to the possibility of the existence of subcultures. And that's a phenomenon that may be elusive to the nurse initially. And Dr. Leininger says that the deeper inner secrets are unlocked as the nurse begins to establish trust with the informant. Like language, ethnohistory influences all other social structure dimensions, as illustrated in Dr. Leininger's Sunrise Enabler. And I really learned about this when I worked in the jail. There's a subculture that exists in the jail. You are who you are, and then there's another subset of living standards that exists between inmates. And so that was something that was sometimes a barrier when you're delivering healthcare, because you would have a patient, I'm trying to think of a really good example, but like I had some patients that were drug addicts and they had drug ulcers, and they were people that came in and out of the jail, and they didn't want other inmates to know that about them, or we had inmates that may have had a sexual identity or a preference on the outside world, but when they came into the jail setting, they had a different set of identities. And then when I would ask them questions and they would come to me and say, I have this problem, and I was doing my assessment, there was inconsistency and incongruency in the information that they were providing me versus what I was seeing in terms of their symptoms. And so the barrier was, there was this big white elephant in the room that nobody was willing to acknowledge, and somebody had to break down the barrier in order for me to be able to address their health need. And it's a very delicate thing to have to skirt around, but again, the basis of it is building trust. When I was able to establish trust with my patient, letting them know, I'm not here to judge, I'm not here to do anything but to help you, then the walls came down and the truth would come forward and I would hear all kinds of things and then find out about other individuals who were in need of health care in the jail setting who were having issues with health but unwilling to come forward with that information because they did not want to disclose what was happening. Cultural assessment has phases for establishing competence. The first phase is cultural rooting and self-assessment. And in this phase, you're going to be looking at yourself, evaluating your personal values and beliefs. And then you also need to look at your ethnocentric tendencies. You need to identify your cultural stereotypes. What are some of the things that you think about other people? This is tough to do because it's uncomfortable. But I read a study that a psychologist put out way back in the 90s, and he said that he studied Southerners and their attitudes towards race. He looked at whites and he looked at blacks and he looked at people that were they had grown up in the South their entire lives, and then he stratified these groups. He looked at people who didn't consider them to be racist or have any bias against blacks, and he looked at blacks who didn't consider themselves to have bias against whites. But the compelling thing, the takeaway from that study was, he said that when people don't look at themselves and they don't identify that they have these stereotypes and ethnocentric tendencies, they tend to be the individuals who continue to perpetuate racism. They tend to be the people who say they don't have those tendencies, but they actually do in the way that they treat people. They bristle, they don't want to be sitting next to a particular individual. And then he said the people who have inner conflict, those are the people who are actually the most effective at being culturally competent, because they recognize that they have these stereotypes. They recognize that they may have these biases towards other people, but they overcompensate by trying to say, I really don't want that person to feel uncomfortable in my presence. I'm going to make sure that I sit next to them, that I engage in conversation. So as a Christian, that's sometimes what we're taught, right? The feeling will come after. Obedience is first. You obey first, you do what's right first, and the feeling will come after. And I think that kind of carries over when you're doing your self-assessment. But again, know thyself, right? Phase two is to develop a holding knowledge. And the way that you do this is to explore diversity in creative and varied ways. And what that means is you can learn so much through reading, attending conferences, and if you have time, one of the things that I really enjoyed about this assignment was that I would learn about one particular culture and then on the internet, as the World Wide Web is a great thing, find another thing and find another thing, and that would feather into, I started out with Hispanic culture, which then was Mexican, then it said Puerto Rican, and then it said Dominican Republic, and so I was learning about all these different nuances to the Hispanic culture, right? And it's not really a culture. Hispanic is referring to Spanish-speaking individuals. And then I had the opportunity to interview an individual who said to me, I consider myself to be Hispanic, but I am Puerto Rican. And she said, there's a big difference between a Puerto Rican and a Cuban and a person from the Dominican Republic. And I said, yeah, that's true. And she said, it goes deeper than food. And then phase three, cultural assessment of others. That's when you start looking at individuals, but you're also looking at departments, organizations, and communities, and you're then using the enablers that we talked about, the Sunrise Enabler and the guides for questioning. And again, in your day-to-day practice, you may be using cultural competence to administer care to your patients, but you also have a global responsibility in using cultural competence to develop policies, to talk about different ways as an organization to administer care. Just like in Christianity, we have our individual responsibilities, but then we have our corporate responsibilities to the world. Culturally sensitive communication, that's the cultural perspective on intimacy. You want to ask the patient about their preferences on how to be addressed. Always introduce yourself. Have you ever been a patient and the person breezes in and they start right into the interview? That's the most uncomfortable feeling, I think, because you're putting your life in their hands and you don't even know who they are. You got to introduce yourself. And the other thing that is a pet peeve of mine personally is when people call me sweetie. I don't like that. And some people don't mind it, right? But you need to know that before you call somebody sweetie, you need to make sure that it's okay with them to call them that. Cultural perspective on silence. There is variation between cultures. And the silence can either be construed as respectful or showing agreement, or it can also be perceived as somebody not paying attention, right? I'm going to talk about that next. In space and distance, because I have an example that kind of goes with this in eye contact. Also, some cultures, you're very, very touchy-feely, you're close. In other cultures, that's a no-no. In the Asian culture, you don't touch each other. But in my husband's culture, he's Serbian, everybody hugs you. You know, you're close. Some people might not like it if you're that way to them. So you need to know that before you're that way. You can still demonstrate kindness and caring without touching somebody. And then lastly, the eye contact. There's variation between cultures on eye contact. Sometimes it's considered a sign of respect, modesty, attentiveness, or it can be construed as rudeness or an avoidance. When I first met my husband, probably about a year after I knew him, my father-in-law confronted me one day. He said, "Lorraine, there's something about you that I don't like." And I was like, "Well, no, what's he gonna say?" He said, "You don't make eye contact with me." And he said, "That makes me feel like you have something to hide." And I said, "Oh no, it's not that way at all." I said, "My mother is Korean, you know that, right? In the Asian culture, I'm not supposed to look you in the eye. I'm being audacious. I'm being rude if I do that. I can look at you in the eye and look away." He goes, "That's exactly what you do. You look at me in the eyes and then you look away." He's like, "You have shifty eye." I said, "No, I really don't." And so this came to mind when I was thinking about culturally sensitive communication. Here you have two people from very different worlds that relate to each other very differently. But without us being able to communicate about it, I try more now to make direct eye contact with him and hold his gaze. And sometimes it's really uncomfortable. And then I make sure, like in the Asian culture with elders, that I don't do that because I don't want to be perceived as somebody that's, you know, in your face. Culturally sensitive communication you must show respect by conveying kindness and patience. You need to observe others without judgment. And the way that you speak to people in low tones, slowly, clearly, avoiding hospital jargon, not using medical terminology or slang. And then you also need to know your stereotypes and be sure to avoid them. So this is basically it in a nutshell. These are the things that we need to be making sure that we do. And I can't emphasize enough the importance of the way you speak. Again, I'm pretty sensitive to this because I have in-laws and my mother, and I used to interpret for my grandmother sometimes. People, you'd shout at them. And I think to myself, they're not hard of hearing. They just don't understand the language. So I wanted to compare two cultures. This is my self-assessment against my interviewee or my informant. So I'm of Korean, Finnish, and German descent. I'm second generation German on my dad's side, Finnish and German, but I'm first generation American because my mother is Korean. And the person that I interviewed was Puerto Rican, and her heritage was French and Spanish. Her father was actually French, and her mother was Spanish, but they ended up, her grandmother was Spanish, rather. Her father served in the military and was in Puerto Rico when he met her mother. I come from a very small family with very strong ties. She comes from a very large family with very strong ties. My family system is very matriarchal. My mom is the decision maker. My mom is the person that, you know, has a lot of authority. And in this woman's culture, although she's matriarchal, That's converse. It's usually patriarchal in her culture. And also in the Korean culture, usually the man is the one who wears, has the seat of responsibility. I thought it was very interesting because although we come from our cultural heritages that are mostly patriarchal, in our individual situations, they were matriarchal. And again, this is where we see the nuances take effect. She's Seventh-day Adventist. I am Seventh-day Adventist. I consider myself to be a friendly person, but I'm very reserved. I'm closed, I'm private, and I'm not really publicly affectionate, although I'm getting better at it now that I've been married to my husband for 16 years. I've learned to hug people a lot more. She's very social, and she's very open and friendly, and that's one of the things that drew me to her was because she was at, I hardly knew her, and she was so warm, like affectionate warm. In my household, we use Eastern and Western medicine practice. And then in her culture or in her home, she chiefly relies on Western medicine. I found myself to be more materialistic and her to be less materialistic. And, it was the afternoon that I spent with her, it was really eye-opening for me on that particular aspect because I've always considered myself to be somebody that can live with or without. I have, with or without. But at the end of the day, when I was with her, I thought to myself, I could live with a lot less and give away a lot more. So I thought, these are good exercises to compare yourself to other people because you really see where you can improve personally. I like to be on time. Although my husband doesn't think so, but I am. I really am. When it comes to things that matter, I'm on time and precise. And I like things to be structured. And I'm what someone would consider to be anal. She's not like that at all. She's very free form, no urgency for time, and punctual. So again, I need to make sure that my values were not imposed on her. I need to leave enough time for us to do the things that we needed to do. I had to be cognizant of her values and not say, well, Lorraine gets done between these set hours because after that I have to go pick up Christian and Abby and have to do. No, I had to make sure that I accommodated that. Professional care practices. We talked about this. These are those etic practices. These are acquired knowledge and skills through formal professional programs in special educational institutions. And these really have to do with health, illness, wellness, and knowledge and practice skills that prevail in professions and professional settings or institutions. And so some of the professional care practices that I like to compare with my informant and myself is that I do participate in annual well visits for myself and family. Unlike my grandmother, I do that. She did as well, my informant. She also was very good about making direct eye contact. She asked a lot of questions. She's unhindered by position or status, and she had respect for elders, but it was conveyed differently. While when I have respect for elders, I convey it as like submissive, she doesn't do that, but you can see that she has respect for elders. So it's interesting because I thought, I want to be like that instead of who I am right now. So I'm going to change. Yeah, so I'm going to change my own ethnohistory, my cultural makeup, right? And then I don't really use very much medication. If a doctor prescribes medication for me, I really go home and think about it before I decide to take it. And I try to employ other practices before I get to that point. And I do participate in herbal and homeopathic remedies. Whereas she also minimally uses medications, and she also believed in some healing foods. And I think this is not so much rooted in my, the herbal medicine and things like that, that's rooted in my cultural heritage, but also being a Seventh-day Adventist really has a play on why I go to foods and healing foods and why she did too. That was something that came up in conversation. She also goes to home, I go to home remedies first, then I seek medical attention. She seeks medical attention as her first line of care. We both had health insurance. I've encountered racism and prejudice from healthcare professionals, not directly, but towards my grandmother, towards my mother, and then most recently with my dad being diagnosed with cancer and some healthcare professionals knowing that we're Seventh-day Adventists. He happens to be Catholic. but he espouses a lot of the Adventist beliefs, and so there was a lot of prejudice. And I could spend an hour on that, but it was interesting. And then lastly, skeptical. I'm skeptical of providers' medical advice, and I know that sounds hypocritical because I'm in the medical profession or the nursing profession. And she was very trusting of providers' medical advice. And then we talk about folk or lay care, and these are culturally learned and transmitted. These refer to home-based or traditional knowledge, skills, or practices. These are used to maintain or improve health and wellness. So these are things that are passed on. So I'm going to share with you, these are a little funnier. This is, these are comparisons between myself and my sister-in-law, who's Serbian. So when we would get sick as little kids, my mom would always peel pears and boil them in honey, and then she would feed that to us whenever we had a respiratory malady. In my sister-in-law's culture, they would use mountain green tea for cough and respiratory illness. Whenever we had bites or infected wounds, my mom would make a charcoal poultice, and I do the same. Abby got bitten by a spider last year. Instead of taking her to the doctor, we made a charcoal poultice, and within 3 days, that thing was all sucked out. I mean, it was huge, red, big, pussy thing, and started to subside within the first day, but by 3 days, it was completely gone. I thought this was funny. My husband told me this, and so did my sister-in-law. She said, when we had fevers, Mom would cut up potatoes, peel the potatoes, cut up the potatoes, put them in our socks, and then she'd give us Motrin and Tylenol. And she said, she swore that the potatoes were the reason why our fevers went down, but and Marianne said to me, but I think it was the Motrin. But you know, that was a value to their mom. She felt like she was doing something. Undershirts and all extremities covered. I remember getting scolded by the pediatrician when Christian was born because he had heat rash because I covered him up too much. She said, I see this very much in the Asian culture. She said, you guys have undershirts on top of undershirts on top of undershirts. And then my sister-in-law's culture, they use moonshine massages for fever. So grandpa would go and into the cabinet and get moonshine and massage all the kids. If they had fever, he would massage them down. And that's actually was a medical practice way back when. It's discouraged now, but we used to do that, right? Alcohol rubs. And then this is something that people would probably find a little bit unusual. Whenever we had digestive problems, my mom would tie my thumbs and with string really tight, and then she would let blood, just from a little bit of blood from my thumb, she would do it on both thumbs, and I'm telling you, my nausea would go away, I would feel fine. I don't know if it was from the pain of being pricked with a needle or what, but it worked. And then in my sister-in-law's culture, they use cabbage leaves on burns. So when someone would get burned, they would grab cabbage leaves and put it on there, and it would work. And then my grandmother would do something called moxibustion. I don't know if you've ever heard of it. It's dried mugwort. And you use that in cupping, or and we also in our culture participate in acupuncture and the use of herbs. And then this was interesting. My sister-in-law, I'll never forget this, my nephew, he's 13 now. When he was born, I used to go over there a lot. I considered him like my first child. I went over there a lot and I said, Marianne, why are his clothes inside out? And she'd go, she didn't say anything to me. Like the third time, I was like, Marianne, are you doing this on purpose? Because I'd switch it out. And she's like, no, don't do that. I said, why are you putting his undershirts on inside out, his onesie? She said, because I got to keep Magia away. I said, what's that? She said, the evil eye and sickness. I said, oh, but you're a Christian and you're Orthodox Christian, not being very culturally sensitive, right? And I said, you don't believe in that, do you? And she said, she just kind of looked at me, right? And so I went to their priest and I said, why do you teach that? He says, we don't teach that, Lorraine. He said, that's what grandma passed down. Grandma passed that down to her. So I asked her recently, and we started laughing about it, and she said, I used to tie, and I said, I remember that. She said, a red string around his wrist, and if she didn't have it around his wrist, sometimes she'd leave it on his crib. And again, it was to keep away sickness in the evil eye. The reason why we talk about that, I'll get to it in a second. So there are three modes of culture care decisions and actions. Culture care preservation and or maintenance, culture care accommodation and or negotiation, and then culture care repatterning or restructuring. These are client focused, and then it's with the goal that care is for or with the patient, not to or on the patient. So the first one is culture, care, preservation, and or maintenance. This is, according to Dr. Leininger, and I haven't formally employed these modes, but I would have to tend to agree, this is the easiest one to employ. And that's where you preserve and you maintain practices, beliefs, values, and expressions of the client in delivering care. So an example of this would be if a person has a dietary restriction, accommodating that. And as Adventists, we're vegetarian, right? We refrain from eating meat. Some people are even vegan. And so in the hospital setting, we need to assess for that so that we can, the last thing you want as a patient, as a Seventh-day Adventist patient, is to have breakfast and then see a giant slab of ham on your tray because you can't eat that, right? So we want to avoid that by doing the proper assessment up front and finding out what their dietary needs are. And then family kinship support practices. This is another one where I'm going to give kudos to the nurses on their end of things. Recently, my dad underwent anointing, and my sister arranged everything, and she had contacted the physician and the nurses, and the physician was kind of like, yeah, well, okay. Not real sensitive to them. The nurses found out. They said, oh, well, what time is it going to be? Who's involved? What is that? And then they made sure to put a sign on the door that said, if anyone needs to go into the patient's room between this time and this time, please come see the nurse first. So she made it, and she made that sign up and then gave that to pass on report to the nurse's aide so that everybody on the floor knew that please respect this hour of time and we don't need to broadcast to everybody what's going on, but that was her way of being able to accommodate something that was of value to us. Culture, care, accommodation, and or negotiation is employed when generic care practices identified need some modification or adjustment, and that's to prevent care conflicts or negative interactions. Negotiation means that you're going to be discussing with the patient or the client beforehand to reach a mutually agreeable compromise regarding how the care is going to be administered. And one of the examples that I thought of was when I was a nursing student, I was downtown Detroit Hospital, and there was a young Chaldean man that was assigned to me as a patient, and he was in his, I think he was only like 19. We weren't very many years apart in age, I remember that, in 19 or 20. And his mom didn't speak hardly any English at all. I mean, she knew hello and goodbye. She knew like the salutation, but as far as like conversation, she didn't, but she never left his side and she was always there. She became really, he was a victim of gunshot wound. They were a family that owned a party store, and he was, he had the night shift and someone came to rob them and he was shot. I mean, from on the torso, there had to, because I had to do the dressing changes, I remember there were like 16 or 17 gunshot wounds, and he had open, they couldn't close him up. They had to do this special type of dressing that had plastic over it, and I remember being a nervous wreck because my professor said to me, that's your patient and you have to do all those dressing changes, and that's what I was focusing on. But as it turned out, there was an even bigger issue that was cultural, where the mom wouldn't leave her son's side, and for some of the dressings, we needed her to leave the room. And so I went to my professor and I said, well, what am I supposed to do? We have to, and she's like, no. She said, we're gonna have to figure this out. So what we ended up doing is we ended up negotiating with the mom. For some of the more benign wounds, we let her stay. But for the ones that required sterile dressing change, you know, we explained to her through an interpreter, there was a family member there that could interpret, that those we would need to do. And she was okay with that. She was okay with, well, as long as I can help, as long as I can be part of it. And then as he got better, because he was there for a number of weeks, as he got better, she was allowed to stay for more and more of the dressing changes. And at a certain point, she was actually allowed to help help do these things with us because she was going to be the primary caregiver when we went home. So it's important to retain, for her, her value was, I need to take care of my son. I need to do these things. She would bring food. They had lots of family. And so we had to negotiate how many visitors were allowed in at a time. We had to negotiate with her what types of food he was allowed to have because he had bowel surgery. So he couldn't eat all the things. And we had to explain to her why. But again, negotiating, saying, this is only temporary. There will come a time when he'll be able to eat these things, but you still can cook for him, and these are the things that you can do. And that made a big difference because she felt like she was actively participating in his wellness or recovery to wellness. And the last one is culture care repatterning and or restructuring. This is indicated when you need to adjust or change the type of care that that they're participating in. And this is specifically speaking to the folk remedies. And that's to ensure client safety and well-being and protecting the client from harm. So repatterning means that you're gonna preserve the pattern, but you're gonna change the format or structure. And an example of this would be to not reuse acupuncture needles. So you can continue to do acupuncture, but please don't reuse the needles. Or allowing a patient, if they have this particular cup that's made out of lead, but it's really important to the family to have somebody drink out of it, then put a liner inside of it. So these are the types of things that we need to do to allow for them to retain their pattern of care, but just restructure it. And then restructuring represents a major cultural change that involves altering a particular behavior or practice that is unsafe or seriously compromises health or well-being. And an example of that would be when this is a practice, I believe, in Egypt, where there's application of lead-based coal to the eyes of newborn infants, and obviously that you worry about lead toxicity and exposure because of that. And then I thought of a really funny example. When Christian was born, my mom made a buckwheat pillow. So it was made out of buckwheat grain, and she covered it with this beautiful fabric, this cotton, and she brought it, and she put it in his crib. And Mimi and the public health nurse knows that you're not supposed to have anything in the crib. Safe sleep means nothing in the crib, no bumper pad, nothing. And so I just left it in there, and I thought, well, I'm not going to have him sleep in the crib. Anyway, he sleeps in the bassinet, so I'll just leave it in there. My husband came home, and he came unglued, and he said, what is that doing in there? You know that he could suffocate from that. You can't have that in the crib. And when I remember, I was thinking about that, then it made me think of some other things that I remember as a public health nurse. I remember visiting one of my clients' homes, and she was here from India and had her baby here, and her mother had never seen her baby yet. And this is in the 90s, so we didn't have iPhones, we didn't have Skype, we didn't have any of that stuff. Anyways, I went to do a home visit, and she had this beautiful bedding that her mother had handmade, and it was out of silk, and it was just gorgeous. Fluffy blanket, it was red, it was beautiful. And she had this in the baby's crib. And I said to her, you know, this is not a safe practice. And she said, I know. And she showed me, she had the brochure that, you know, it shows what safe sleep is supposed to look like. And I said, but you know, this bedding is so beautiful. I think that we should figure out a way to be able to utilize this in the baby's room. So I said, why don't we put the bumper pad on the outside of the crib? And she said, oh, I never thought about that. So we put the bumper pad on the outside of the crib. And then I said, this blanket, we could hang it on the wall. It could be like a picture for the baby. And she said, yeah, I think I can do that. And so this was an opportunity to take something that was unsafe because we wanted to avoid, you know, infant suffocating in the bed, but able to retain what was important to her because her mother had made that. And that was a piece of her mom there that was swaddling her baby, but she felt like her mom was still there because she was in the room with the baby. And so I'd like to close by showing you this picture. This is the same thing as this. Very different, right? The way that they look. I leave you with this thought. When we are taking care of people, when we are ministering to others, we need to keep in mind that that moment, that encounter, that point in time is a single perspective. It's their perspective and our perspective from different angles. You're not always going to be able to know that person's perspective, but you can always be culturally competent in the way that you deliver your care. And that is by making sure that you treat other people with dignity and respect. When you have a patient in front of you, you won't know necessarily, you won't have time to know and dig into their culture, but you will know by being a human being, and especially a Christian human being, that we are creatures of our Heavenly Father who made us, right? And so we are all of the same, we are the same fabric. And kindness, respect, and love for our fellow man is a universal trait. It's a common thread. And so if you make a mistake, you can always apologize for it, right? Because it's not about stopping yourself from making a mistake, although we don't want to make mistakes. But if you make a mistake, we certainly can learn from them. And it's a very endearing quality to be able to tell people, I messed up, how can I do this better? So in order for you to not be that individual that sees things like this, but instead to be this person that recognizes there's a bigger picture, I leave you with Romans 12:10. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Give preference to one another in honor. Thank you. Do you have any questions? Yeah.
So your musts, your list of musts.
Yeah.
I just want to say that even though you were speaking from a nursing perspective and how that related to taking care of patients, we really could use those in our work to spread the word. Those musts can work for you, they can work for us. They're all the same. So just because your talk tonight was very, very good.
Well, thank you.
Maybe you can relate to everybody in here, but there were clearly some ideas that you had that we can all take, use in our daily work in spreading the Lord's word and how we treat other people.
Yeah. Thank you. One thing that I want that I forgot to mention is that while you might not be directly a provider of healthcare, you are a consumer of it. Everyone is, right? And I hope that the discussion that we had tonight, this talk that we had, empowers you a little bit more to know what expectations you should have of your providers. And sometimes it's going to require you to educate them, unfortunately. Some people are going to come into the practice knowing how to be good doctors. I mean, Mr. Chapman told me about Mrs. Chapman's surgeon and just how wonderful she is, right? And then you hear horror stories about some people that have absolutely no clue. What's the divide? It's the respect that you have for another person. Again, these are things that as patients you should know, I have certain rights. And it's not always about beating people over the head with them, because I think that's sometimes where people get uncomfortable and they think, well, I'm not confrontational. Nobody likes confrontation, but you absolutely have the right to, you know, assert your beliefs, assert your values. And I think as Seventh-day Adventist Christians, we already are a little marginal sometimes in the way that we do things. And then because of that, we are marginalized for it. But that's taught us to have a little bit more gumption, I think, in character development, because we as Christians learn the nuance of being able to be assertive and stand up for what we believe in without being offensive. But I think sometimes we let that guard down when we're within these walls, like you're saying. And so then we lack that respect for one another. We lack that caring, and we lack, because we're like, you're Christian, you know how you should handle yourself. And if I offend you, you should get over it because you're a Christian, right? No, you know, you still hurt people's feelings and you still discourage people and you still uplift people. So it's a two-way street. And that's where, when we come to a deficit in anything that we do, be it professionally or personally, you know, the first thing that I never put on these things in my slide, but the first thing that we have to do is be broken at the feet of Jesus. And the first how for anything is to pray. And it doesn't have to be, if you're in a work situation or you're in the middle of an argument with a spouse or a child, you can say a prayer right then and there and say, God, I don't know how I'm going to fix this. I can't tell you how many times it's happened to me where I'm in the middle of, my mouth is like this because I'm getting ready to yell something. And then the thought is like, dear God, I don't know how I can fix this. There's no way. But you said that with you, all things are possible. And then I close my mouth. And that was a miracle right there. And then after closing my mouth, I walked away. That's the second miracle. And then the third miracle and fourth and fifth miracle comes. And then everything's at peace, right? And God says, I will teach you these things. You know, lay them at my feet. And so I leave that with you this evening. In this day and age where it's so easy to get angry because there are so many injustices and life is hard, and we're studying Job right now, we know that the devil actively seeks, the Bible says, seeking whom he may devour. Devour means to not leave a single remnant of you, to eat you up completely so that there's nothing left of you. Isn't that how we feel a lot these days? Isn't that how life feels like? Every angle that the devil is there to pervert, to make hard for you. God says, I already won the victory. The only thing we have to do is to hang on to him and not let go. And the way you do it, when you mess up, say I'm sorry for it. You mess up with people, say you're sorry for it. And then even if you don't feel like saying you're sorry, say you're sorry for it, and then go tell God in secret. I didn't feel sorry when I said it. I said sorry, but I didn't feel sorry. God will help you feel sorry. And then you'll be nice. And it's a process, just like we were talking about before. Everything is a process. Don't worry about the end point. Worry about right now, the here and now. If we could bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time that we could spend together. And Lord, we ask that you help us, that you help us become your children. We want to obey you. We want to serve you. And we thank you for sending Jesus to die on the cross. Thank you for giving us the opportunity to have salvation. And may we always remember your sacrifice and his, and then remember that the Holy Spirit is with us to help us each and every day, every step of the way. Thank you for being our Savior and King, and may you be glorified always. In all of these things we ask in your precious and holy name. Amen. Thank you.